consistent giving. We need to put our stewardship of giving as a plan, being consistent as we before we even come to church. When we're getting paid, even as a child, when you receive a gift financially, you need to think about giving part of that to the ministries. As a grandmother who does not work, but you get money here or there, you're not poor. Give back to the Lord so that this gospel can reach those who are not able to give. Blessed are those who give, for they shall be inheriting the kingdom of God. This means that all of us can help in the work of God, giving gifts, time. We can give our time, donate our time in the evangelistic work. It can be doing something with the different departments, children's departments, women's department, prayer ministry department, and many other ways that we can also devote our time. Let's look at what the Bible says about stewardship. Who owns your money? Yes, God owns it all. And we have been studying the book of Psalms, and the book of Psalms, chapter 24, verse 1 says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it." It means that we're simply taking care of God's properties and money. Our money is not our own. So stewardship is properly managing the resources that God has given to our care. We need to teach our children early in their years good economy of money management. This is called good stewardship. Now, stewardship and using God's money. We need to think and ask ourselves, what does God want us to do with his money since he owns everything? How can we use money in our Christian life? Money serves a lot of purposes. Some of them can be, it can be a tool to shape our lives. That means we need to be consistent in whatever it is that we are doing, our offerings, and also giving our tithes. Money can be a test of trust and obedience to God. And we know that a lot of family members have failed us. A lot of us probably have family members who came with good faith wanting to borrow, but you never saw them again. But when it comes to God and you're praying to God to give you this and give you that, God comes through, and there are reasons sometimes we just don't get exactly what we're asking for. Because God knows the future of what that might be a harm. It could be a detriment to you. Money can be a testimony to shine the light to the dark world, especially those who are less privileged in our society. Also, how much is enough money? Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 says, "Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, 'Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you.'" Amen? Amen. Decisions we have to make in life, we have to be content with whatever God has designated to us or has given us to manage. We have to spend less than we earn. It is a habit that we can form. It's very difficult because when you see something, you want it regardless of how much you have. But with practice and the Holy Spirit, we will overcome. Amen? We have to give generously because when you give generously, it breaks the power that money has over us. We have to avoid debt because being in debt can ruin your future or my future. We should always plan for the unexpected. We should always set long-term goals, because being a good steward leads to commitment, being confident, and better communication with our families. A lot of our family issues are always, if you really listen very well, something about money will come up or has been coming up. And it trickles and it ruins families because of no communication when it comes to money. So some of the reasons why we should give. When we give, we bring great blessings. We get a lot of blessings and happiness to ourselves. When you give, you notice that you're making the other person happy. And what does that in return do to you? You feel good about yourself. It makes us feel very good that we are making somebody happy. And in turn, we have people that we cannot see here in spreading the gospel, and our monies go a long way. So just imagine what your giving has done for others who were not privileged to be able to do for themselves. We give as a result of obedience because we love God. Giving brings blessings because in Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6, it says, we should trust God. God blesses those who love and keep his commandments. Exodus chapter 20, verse 10 says, we show gratitude by returning to God a portion of what he has given to us through our tithes and offerings. Through our tithes and offerings, yes. Tithes and offerings, yes. Giving strengthens our faith and trust because we know that God has in more than 1,000 ways provided for us in front of us and behind the scene. And a lot of things that have been prevented that we have no idea. And when we even know that this is what God has done for us, we're so amazed. We should give cheerfully. Luke chapter 6, verse 38 says, give and it should be given unto you. God promises those who use the talent of wealth to bless others, and he will repay in rich dividends. That's a good word. We love to hear in financial monies or when we talk about finances, having great dividends. And we know being a good steward has dividends that we can never count of, regardless of where or what that you have been doing. Psalms chapter 34, verse 25 says, I have never seen the righteous forsaken or their children begging bread. So brothers and sisters, fellow Christians, our members here at Houston International SDA Church, return your tithes and offerings consistently and see what God will do for you this year and the years to come. May we continue to trust God and return our tithes and offerings faithfully. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath. I want to welcome you all to this divine worship, and to those who are watching us online, we want to say happy Sabbath and thank you for joining us. I pray that the blessings of the Sabbath will be yours as well in Jesus' name. Yeah, I see our faces. We are all smiling. We are all bright. We thank God, right? Thank God for his mercies, just as we have learned in this week's lesson study. God's mercies endures forever. And you know, during the week, at the beginning of the week, I saw a lot of things that I needed to do, and I felt a little overwhelmed. But then when I looked at Jesus and what he can do, I was encouraged. And then I went through the week, and here I am, victorious. And I know that's the same story you have. We thank God for that. So before I proceed with the announcement, I want to recognize those who are worshiping with us for the first time. If you are worshiping with us for the first time, please let us know you. Tell us your name and where you are coming from. Don't be shy. This is your house. This is the house of your Father. God is our Father, right? So don't be shy. Can you please let us meet you? Amen, 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 amen. Welcome. And the Lord will perfect that healing in Jesus' name. We are very happy to see you. And anytime you are in Houston, please worship with us. We want to see you. All right, that would be great. Thank you. Any other visitor? Oh, yes. From Angola. Thank you for worshiping with us. May God bless you. And please, can you please give them warm welcome? If you're close to them, please give them a handshake and get to know them better. And, you know, give them warm welcome, please. I can see all over you. We can do more of the greetings after the service. I know we're very happy to see one another. This is the family of God, and we thank God for that. All right, let's be seated. At this time, I want to invite the church clerk. We have some church business to take care of. That's the transfer of membership. Sister Julia.
Thank you. Good morning and happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
I think I'm Sabbath to you, church members and visitors. I think I'm getting a look of what heaven will look like. Amen. Different faces, different sizes. Furthermore, we're going to have brand new bodies, won't we?
Yes.
Okay, I have, where's Pastor Ron? Oh, he's right here. I have the second reading for, let me do the first ones first. The first readings are for two of our members that are leaving us, and the first one is Carolyn Shrugs. She is moving to Houston Central SDA, and then we have Lawrence Madojimo. Am I calling that right?
Yes.
Okay. He is leaving us to go to Katy SDA. So we're losing two of our members, and this is their first reading. The second and final reading is for Pastor Rhone, is for Omari M. He's leaving us to go to Houston Nations of Praise SDA, and this is the second reading. Gary, thank you. Have a happy Sabbath.
Thank you, Sister Juliet. Now, who can tell me what's going to happen here tomorrow? What program do we have here tomorrow? Thank you. So we are all aware. So as many as responded, you are supposed to be here tomorrow.
Amen.
You know that, right? So please, let us come tomorrow, February 18th, at 12 noon. I know we probably had 11 a.m., but the program was shifted to 12 noon. So please, let us all come out and support this family. You know, for those who didn't know, Sister Ibanzo was over 100 years old. And, you know, she was a giant of faith. And let us come out and support the family. This is our grandmother, our mother, our great-grandmother. So let us support the family. I pray the Lord will bless us. And also on the 24th, we have a memorial service for another giant of faith, Elder Josiah. And that will be at 5 p.m. And for that reason, there will be no AY Vespers on that day. So for those who always come to AY Vespers, you should still come for that memorial service. Please let us support the family as well. Next Sabbath is Children's Sabbath. Can we put that on the screen, please? Children's Sabbath, next Sabbath. Let's come and celebrate. Let's come and appreciate what God is doing in the lives of our children. And you know they are the pillar of the church tomorrow. 2024 Easter Choir concert is on March 23 at 2:30 p.m. It promises to be a very inspiring one. So please let us attend this concert. And also for the youth, we have the week of prayer, March 16th to 23rd. And that would end there is going to be a Global Youth Day on March 16th. And the theme is show up in the cities. And then the youth week of prayer will start on the 16th, March 16th, and end on March 23rd. Also, from the personal ministry department, we have evangelistic series that's coming up on April 14th. It will run through April 28th. And it's going to be every night at 7 p.m. It's entitled Take Charge of Your Health. And the speakers will be Dwayne and Alexandra Lemon. Also from the Personal Ministry Department, we have a mission trip to Kenya. How many of us wants to visit Kenya? Amen. 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 I've not been there, but I learned Kenya is very beautiful. Yes. So let's plan to go July 7th to 16th. July 7th to 16th. All who will be interested in participating should please submit their names to Sister Muja, who is the Personal Ministry Director, by February 25th. We only have a few days. So please, by February 25th, submit your name to Sister Muja if you're interested in going to Kenya for that mission trip. Let's continue to remember our TLT Pathfinders. They are still at Lake Whitney Ranch for their training. They will be back tomorrow. Let's keep them in our prayers. And I want to remind you, your tithe receipts are still there. A lot of people have not collected theirs. Please endeavor to, it's either in the front or the side of the church. Please endeavor to pick yours. You may need it for your tax returns. Also, men ministry program tomorrow in the morning at 6:30. All men are enjoined to join the program online. Also, we have the Bible study this evening. We're still studying the book of Hebrews, and that's at 4 o'clock. And then, of course, we know on Monday we have the Spirit of Prophecy. So this is a very busy church, and we're supposed to be, right? Amen. We're supposed to be busy for the Lord. Yes. Amen. Amen. All right, so as we prepare our minds for this divine service, I pray that the Lord will continue to be with us. You'll still hear more announcements later. There is a good news, and that's regarding the Elder Cliff and family. You hear more about that later, and then, we have a special prayer for the family. Also, later we would invite KD Adventist School for their promotion, but that will be much later. And please stay tuned, and more importantly, let our minds be here. Let our hearts be here, because we are here to worship our God. I pray the Lord will bless us.
Good morning and happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Are we happy to be in the house of the Lord?
Yes.
It's been a week for some of us, but thank God we made it to the end of the week.
Amen.
So it's night time for our praise and worship, and our first song will be song number 88, I Sing the Mighty Power of God.
The mountains rise.
we also sing the power of God. Let us praise him, for he inhabits the praise of his people. If you want to stand to praise God, please stand up and sing with us. We are here to praise him. Our next hymn is hymn 245, More About Jesus.
With me. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Heavenly Father, you're welcome in this place. Son of God, you're welcome in this place. Come and teach us how to worship. Come and teach us how to sing. Teach us how to pray. Teach us how to listen. Come and give us a humble heart and an obedient spirit. Lord, be in our heads and in our thinking, in our hands and in our serving, in our feet and in our going, in our hearts and in our loving, in our mouths and in our speaking, in our ears and in our hearing, in our eyes and in our seeing. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
While we remain standing, we'll open our hymn books to hymn 195 for our opening song, Showers of Blessing. This is the time that, one of the times that we all partake. We are here to bring our burdens. We are here to lay down everything and just focus on God. So if you have any burden on your heart today, please feel free to come forward. I know there's a special prayer for Elder Cliff and his family, but there is never too much prayer. So please come forward also. And before we pray, is there any special prayer requests? Please feel free to shout it out. Any special prayer requests? Almighty. Let people everywhere join us now in prayer. We come with our hearts lifted, dear God. We praise you, for you are God and God all by yourself. All glory, honor, majesty we ascribe to you, Father. Amen. We thank you for bringing us thus far. Amen. Safely through another week, you have brought us, Heavenly Father. We say thank you for life. Thank you for traveling mercies. Thank you for your daily provisions. Thank you, dear God, that we are here together praising your holy name. Thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, for your Holy Spirit. Thank you for your holy angels that are here with us surrounding this building, dear Lord. You are so great. You are awesome. You are marvelous. You are wonderful. You are faithful. You are King of Kings. You are Jehovah Jireh. You are Jehovah El Shaddai. You are Jehovah Shalom. Father God, all glory to your holy name. Lord, we have nothing to bring you but praise. We praise you, for you deserve praise, for worship belongs to you and you only. Amen. Father God, as we kneel here today, and some of us stand, Lord, you know our hearts, Father. What is the burden that we are carrying, Lord? Let us leave these burdens here today. Is there a financial burden, Lord? Is there a marital issue, Father God? Is there a health issue, Heavenly Father? Is there a mother or father praying for their child, Heavenly Father? Whatever those burdens are, Lord, we leave them here at the foot of your throne. It is not for us to pick up, because you are faithful in whatever you say to your Lord. So as we are here today, Father, we ask, Lord, that you fill us with your Holy Spirit and that this worship be in spirit and in truth, dear God. We pray a special prayer, Lord, for Edel Cliff and his family as they prepare to travel. Lord, grant them traveling mercies. And all those that are traveling, Lord, we pray for traveling mercies. We pray for the Wakaleme family. We pray for the Gold, the Morrison family at this moment as they mourn the loss of their loved ones. But Father God, they are not mourning, because those that are sleeping, they are sleeping in you, dear Lord. So we just give them to you, and we ask you to provide the comfort that they need. Father God, we thank you for this church. We bring this choir to you, Lord. As we minister today, let us not entertain, but may we minister to someone who walk in here today looking for your blessing, looking for answer for your, to prayers, dear Lord. May we minister, may your angels come down, Lord, and sing with us that your name may be glorified. Amen. And as we hear the word today, Lord, may you speak through our pastor, Father God. May you speak through him, not only to the church, but also to himself, dear Lord. Amen. Bring change in us, Father God. Bring reformation in us, dear Lord. We thank you for our visitors, Lord. May their coming here not be in vain. We thank you for every family, Father God. We glorify your name. For these and many more, in the mighty and holy name of Jesus Christ, I've prayed with thanksgiving. Amen.
Children's story. It's a great day to praise the Lord. It's a great day to praise the Lord. It's a great day to praise the Lord. Walking in the light of God. It's a great day to praise the Lord. It's a great day to praise the Lord. It's a great praise the Lord, walking in the light of God. Walk, 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 walk in the light. Walk, 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 walk in the light. Good morning, children. Today I have the pleasure of sharing with you today's children's story. Before I share the story with you, I'm going to say some words and tell me if you could picture those words in your mind. Dog. Can you see a dog? Is it a big dog, a small dog? Horse. Can you see a horse? Yes. What color is the horse? What about a tree? Can you picture a tree? Does it have any fruits on it? What about general? Can you picture a general? Do you know who's a general? Can someone tell me who's a general?
A leader of an army.
Leader of an army?
A commander of a group of people.
Commander of a group of people. Very good. So today's story, we're talking about a general or a commander in the army. And this commander, this general, is in the Bible. Do you know any commanders in the Bible?
How God created the world?
No. Do you know any commanders in the Bible? Do we know any commanders? Okay, so mommies and daddies, I want you to share the commanders with your kids.
Joshua?
Yes, Joshua is a commander.
Gideon?
Gideon was a commander. Very good. So this commander, he led his army into battle. And the Bible says he was brave. He was full of courage. You can't have a scaredy commander leading the people now. And he was very victorious. That meant he won his battles. But the thing is, he wasn't part of the people of God. And who's the people of God? The Israelites. So this commander was not an Israelite. And I know you know who this commander is because you've heard this story a lot of times before. But I'm not going to say it. So hopefully by the clues in the story, you're going to figure out, who is the commander? So this commander fought against the people of Israel, and he won. And because he won, his king was really happy with him.
And so one day, something happened. This man who was really, really high, very honorable, loved by all his people, something happened to him. He got really, really sick. He was so sick that he had to stay by himself for a while. And when his king heard that his general was sick, the king was like, no, we gotta pray for our general because it takes a miracle to heal the general. So the king gathered the armies together, the people together, and they went to the temple to pray. And they were praying. But the thing is, they were praying to an idol, an image. And so do you think that idol image could hear the prayers? No, the Bible says when you create an image with your hands, that image cannot hear, cannot speak. So they were praying in vain. They were saying, please, please, please heal the general. And the thing is, the general also had a wife. And so, do you think you know who the general is? Yeah? You? Jesus?
Naaman?
Very good. It was Naaman. And so Naaman, his wife also went to the temple to pray for a miracle, for a healing. And no miracle came. And when Naaman went into battle, he raided Israel and he brought back a little girl. And this little girl knew that Naaman was her enemy who snatched her from her parents' home. But still she had compassion, because when she saw Naaman's wife crying, she said, I know someone who can heal Naaman. And so when Naaman heard, Naaman sent news to the king, and the king said, you know what? I'm going to write a letter to the king of Israel because I want my general to be healed. He's been successful for me in battle, and I want him to get better. And so he sent Naaman to the king of Israel. And when the king of Israel read the letter, the king of Israel became really afraid and really scared. And he was like, this king just sent men into my country to raid my country. What do you want me to do? Does he think I am Jesus, that I am God? Yeah. To heal Naaman, what am I going to do? I am not God to heal this man of leprosy. And so he ripped his clothes off his body. And when news came to the prophet, who was the prophet? Who was the prophet, children? It was Elisha. And when Elisha heard about what the king did, Elisha said, don't worry, send him to me. And so Naaman went to Elisha, and Elisha didn't even come out to see Naaman. And that made Naaman really, really angry, because Naaman thought that this prophet would come and say some words and he would be changed. His disease, his leprosy would go away. But that wasn't what happened. Naaman had to exercise some faith. Boys and girls, we got to exercise some faith. When God tells us to do something, we got to exercise our faith. We got to put some actions. And so the simple instruction was to do what? Go to the river and dip how many times? Seven times. And Naaman didn't want to do it at first. But Naaman knew that he wanted to be free from this illness. And so he went to the river and he dipped. Count with me. One, two,
three, four, five, six, seven.
You know, Naaman could have stopped at one dip. When he went down and came up, I'm sure he looked at his skin and be like, I still got this leprosy. I still got this skin disease. He could have stopped at two. He could have stopped at three. But what was the instruction? To go how many times?
Seven
times. And so after the seventh time, he came up and he was healed. And not only that, Naaman's physical condition was healed, but also his mind was changed, because now he know that, hey, the gods in my country could not heal me. Only the God of Israel could heal me. And so the Bible tells us that Naaman was an enemy of God's people, but God could even use his enemies for his good. Because the New Testament tells us that a lot of lepers were in Israel. A lot of lepers were among God's people, but God didn't heal none of them. God only chose Naaman, who was a stranger, who was an enemy of Israel. So boys and girls, as you grow, be like the little girl. Pray for your enemies. And not only that, have compassion for people who are sick. And tell them that there is a God who can heal them, just like this little girl. So boys and girls, that's the end of our story. Like always, I would invite you to stand as we sing a little song to remind you of the story of Naaman. There's a lot of different songs about Naaman, but this is the one that I grew up with, and I wanted to teach you guys. So stand with me and try to see if you can do the actions, okay? There was a man I know, a leper white as snow. He went to the river to wash his sins away. And his name was Naaman. And he dip one dip, and he dip two dips, and he dippy dip three, four, five, six, seven. Then he came up clean. We'll do it one more time. There was a man I know, a leper white as snow. He went to the river to wash his sins away. And his name was Naaman. And he dip one dip, and he dip two dips, and he dippy dip three, four, five, six, seven. Then he came up clean. Amen, boys and girls. So can I have two children to pray for us? Be brave. Come on, Joanna. We have usual. Boys and girls, we're going to pray. Let's close our eyes. You want to pray too? Okay. Isaiah's going to pray.
Dear Jesus,
thank you for this day.
Children.
Thank you for our children.
Children.
Thank you for our moms and daddy.
Thank you for our moms and daddy.
Bless us.
Bless us.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen. Close your eyes and bow your head. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the people that are here. Help us to learn about you, Lord. Make sure that we know you. Help the people that are poor or sick and the people that cannot have enough money to get their stuff, the stuff that they need. Lord, help the people around us. Lord, help us to be brave and help people who don't know you. Make sure that we love you because you created us. And in Jesus' name, amen.
Father, Heavenly God, let us bow our heads. Please let us have a wonderful day. Let us have a blessed day. Let us learn about how we learned that we can trust you, and we can trust you so that we can praise you, that you can heal us our minds and pure us from our sins. Please let the children have wisdom for next Sabbath, because they will be telling us how we listen to God and we praise him. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, Church. Thank you for having me today. Pastor Rome asked me how much time I needed to do what I want to tell you. And after sitting here for Sabbath school, I need to ask Pastor Rome's permission. I said 2 minutes. May I say 5 minutes? Reason being is this. I have been convinced that when God works in your life, you have to give your testimony. Otherwise, why is he doing it? And I just want to give this testimony that just happened to me this week and how it ties in with Adventist education. You see, I've worked in my company for more than 21 years. I started when I was really young. And with a click of a mouse, I found out on Tuesday I had no medical insurance, no vision insurance, no dental insurance. And the only reason I found out is because my dentist called and said, hey, you have an appointment. Lori, did you realize you have no insurance? And I said, no, you're crazy. I've been in this company for 20 years, and my insurance has been with them. How can that be? He said, just find out. So I called Human Resources, looked at my benefits, and nothing. Wow. Like, everything was erased. 1 second, my life was fine. The second, it was like, how can this happen? Lots of emails, lots of phone calls. And as you can imagine, I was like, oh, now this is really funny. A case manager registered nurse with no insurance. That is so ironic. And you know, every person that I went to, I was told, there is nothing you can do. You have choices. Wait till November, which means have no insurance for this whole time. Find another job. Go somewhere else. In a click of a second. In all that chaos, I was sitting at my desk on Wednesday, and this voice, as clear as a bell, said, Lori, be still. Watch me work. Let me work. And be faithful. I was off on Thursday, came back on Friday to work, went all day, and right before closing time, I get an email. And it says, we have never done this before. It is a very, very extremely rare exception that we will grant you your benefits back. Yeah. So my testimony is God still does miracles today. Amen. He is still faithful to you today. But God also asks something of you. How does this tie in with Adventist education? The deacons are going to pass out some flyers, and I'm not going to dwell on it. The reason I'm here is because, as they said in Sabbath school, dividends and money and owing, but with all that comes a plan. And we're already starting to plan for next year for children, 2024-2025, in which we wanted to be sure that you as members had the opportunity to get the best financial possibility for Adventist education. And you're going to say, well, Lori, how does that do with your testimony? How does that fill in with your testimony? Here it is. Whether it's your life, whether it's your time, whether it's your money, whether it's your family, be faithful. Amen. Be faithful to God. Even when you think circumstances cannot be resolved humanly, be still. Know that He is God. Amen. Know that He will work for you
It may not be what your outcome you think you will be, but it will be the outcome that you need. But we must sometimes be silent. And we must sometimes step out in faith, even when we think things are impossible. Adventist education makes a difference. And parents, if you do have children, those that are online listening to this, I would like to encourage you. God has given you the most worthy treasure on this earth. He has bestowed it upon you. Place your treasure in his house. So for those of you, if you have a Bible, I just want to end with this. My 5 minutes is up. But I wanted to give this because I wanted to end my testimony with this. 2 Thessalonians 3:3. 2 Thessalonians 3:3. But the Lord is faithful, who shall establish you and keep you from evil. Be ye faithful. He is faithful to you. Thank you. Your deacons will have these flyers. Just ask them about it, about the school.
We say amen. Amen. That's a powerful testimony. God answers prayer. And Sister Lori is our board chair for the Katie School. She works hard for no pay in rebuilding. So God rewarded your effort. It is not unfaithful to forget what you do. And that is a tremendous testimony. God answers prayers a lot in this church, doesn't he? A lot. And he ought to get the glory. Elder Cliff, come on up here. God just, and your family. God answered a powerful prayer for Elder Cliff recently. Elder Cliff has been praying for a lot of people. And he prays with me a lot in the week at different times over a number of us. And many times God answered his prayers for you. And now God has answered your prayers for him. Amen. So he's getting ready to fly off to Kenya. Amen. And the family is here to request special prayer that we pray over him. And because God answered prayer for Sister Lori, and he has answered prayer for Elder Cliff and his family, and has now started the beginning of greater things for Elder Cliff, who is the first elder of our church, for those who are visiting. We have Sister Marilyn here. Sister Marilyn is here for cancer treatment. Sister Okachi and Abigail's prayer group have been praying for her for a long time. And so she's here for special treatment. So we want to include her in this prayer, that the God who answers prayer for Sister Lori and Elder Cliff will answer a prayer for Marilyn. Marilyn's mom, could you come along, please? And so we are asking for a miracle again this morning. Amen. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So I'm going to invite everyone to stand and just ask you to put your hand forward in faith that God will work through you and reach out. Your hand going forward is a symbol of faith that God will answer the prayer for special travel, for safe travel, and also for seizures for Marilyn. Amen. Amen. Elder Cliff, you have an announcement?
Yes, I wanted to call upon Elder Chai to come down, please. Yeah, just before we pray, I really want to thank God for this answered prayer. There's something, I just tell you, there's nothing so hard for God. There's nothing. Whatever you're going through, God will answer your prayers. Wherever it is, I know everybody has a burden in their heart or something in their heart. No, God loves you. His timing is always the best. And I really want to thank all the prayer warriors. There are so many. There's a reason I called Elder Chaik here. He's a brother to me. And there's so many more. My wife, my parents, my family. I can name so many people. It's the power of prayer. People, let's pray for one another. Let's remember one another in prayer. There's nothing so hard for God. I'm just so joyful this day. My family, please raise your hands. I see you up there. Thank you. You guys have been prayer warriors for my family. So many people, I can take forever to mention them, but I'm so joyful. Thank you, God.
May I invite elders to come forward and lay hands on these two individuals for us, please, as we pray. The elders that are here, just quickly lay your hand on Cliff and on Marilyn at this time. Marilyn, you want to say something as the elders are coming forward?
God works miracles, and I'm just so thankful for all your prayers, and you encourage me, and so I'm thank you.
Amen. Just raise your, put your hand forward in faith, and just trust God. It'll work. Father God in heaven, Lord, we stand in your courts, we stand in your presence. As Hannah stood before you years ago, lifting our faith to you, Father, we are grateful. You deserve all the glory, all the honor, all the praise. Forgive us for not glorifying you enough. Forgive us for not trusting you enough. Forgive us, Lord, for not following you enough. Today, Lord, wipe our slate clean. And help us to begin afresh in coming after you. Lord, thank you for Sister Lori, her hard work at the Katy School, and the miracle you performed for her this week. To you belong the glory. Thank you for speaking to her and granting her peace. Father, today we also want to thank you for Marilyn. She's standing here in your presence, and we know you like to be tested. Father, we are asking for a testimony out of Marilyn. If there's no test, there can be no testimony. So she's going through her test at this time. And God, today, in humility, we, the members of the Houston International Church, pray over her. We unite our faith with her. And Patience Prayer Band and Sister Abigail and Sister Okachi and all those who labor in prayer over her. She's here in church today for a reason. Don't disappoint her, Lord. In the name of Jesus. And Lord, we hold your son and his family before you. Elder Cliff, Omegwa, his wife and kids. Father, he's a hard worker for his family. Hard worker for his church. Lord, for your church. He has such humility, such patience. You have blessed him with so many gifts of diplomacy, of an ambassador, of a statesman, of a Christian gentleman. And today, Lord, you have come through for him. Amen. He's standing here with his family to give you the glory. Amen. And Lord, he's also asking for journeying mercies as he goes back to his parents, to his family, to his relatives, to his friends, to his community, as he travels over land and air and sea with vehicles and aeroplanes and legs. Lord, he beg you to keep him safe. Amen. And when he turn up anywhere, he doesn't want to turn up alone. He wants to know that you are with him. When he speaks your words. May wherever he goes, whichever home he goes through, whoever he touches, may he leave life and light behind. Thank you, Lord, today. And Lord, we just pause for a moment because there are others in this congregation with special requests. As you're passing through and as you're working, Lord, answer prayers, we pray. Amen. The private prayers and the quiet prayers. And when you have answered, may we come back here and, like Elder Cliff, give you the glory. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Amen. Happy Sabbath, everyone. My name is Rahila, and it's time for us to show our gratitude to God, right? Offering time. And so far today, we've heard a lot of people giving thanks to God for his goodness in their lives. What are you grateful for today? When you look back over your past week, is there a moment or interaction that you can thank God for? I encourage you to take a moment to thank God for whatever is filling your heart with gratitude at this moment. At this moment, I'm very grateful for the Word of God, especially Hebrews chapter 11, sometimes referred to as the faith chapter. As we face different challenges in different seasons of our lives, it is incredibly refreshing to be reminded of God's faithfulness. Today, as we return our offering, let us return to God our tithes and offerings from a heart overflowing with gratitude. God loves a cheerful giver. Okay, so may the deacons wait on us as we sing Count Your Blessings. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for today. We thank you especially for all the testimonies that we've heard. Thank you for seeing us throughout the week, and thank you even for the testimonies that we will be hearing soon, Father. Lord, thank you for your provision as we have returned tithes and offerings. Oh Lord, we pray that you bless them, oh Lord, that they will be used to for your glory. Father, King of Glory, may you provide for those who do not have, O Lord, and continue to sustain those that we're able to give as well. May your name be glorified now and forevermore, for I have prayed in Jesus' name.
Happy Sabbath. By God's grace, I know we came to church with our Bibles. Amen?
Amen.
Shall we rise as we take our scripture reading? So our scripture reading today is going to be taken from 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4, we are going to be taking it from verse 1. To 8. Are we there?
Yeah.
All right, you reach. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. 5. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. Verse 6. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith.
Amen.
Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness,
Amen.
Which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love is appearing.
Amen.
May the Lord bless his reading in Jesus' name.
It didn't sound like we are here. I have glasses and I can remove them, but I can still see a sea of humanity here. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Yeah, you are here. Praise God. Yeah. We are going to sing music here to praise God. The question that I will float to you guys here is this. We have about 10 billion people in the world today. If each one of them was to be given a pen to write what God has done for one of you, they will still not be able to write it. God has done wonderful things in our life. The only thing we'll just say is he has done marvelous and wonderful things. That is the theme of our song, and may you remain blessed.
It is wonderful what Jesus has done for this soul of yours, the half, are you there? Has never been told. Amen. Thank you, choir. Amen. It is wonderful. Amen. Learn to count our blessings. Learn a spirit of thankfulness and a spirit of gratitude. Can you say amen? It's a joy to be here this morning to worship our God in spirit and in truth. That's why we're here. Welcome to all those who are visiting. Welcome to those online. I'm Denton Rhone, pastor of the church. Welcome to our members. Welcome to our friends. It's a joy to be here. I have three announcements to make. Two I'll make now and the one at the end of the sermon. The first one has to do with our funeral tomorrow. Dr. Ibanzo has been faithful in the Seventh-day Adventist Church for over 100 years. I know that many of us will not make it to 100. Most of us, but you still can say amen. Amen. She has been here for over 100 years. She's gone to her rest, and tomorrow we are having the funeral service for her. She's been shut in for a while, but I would love for all of us to be out here tomorrow to honor 100 years of faithful membership within the church. So wherever you are tomorrow at 12 o'clock, let us be here for an hour, hour and a half, and honor this great woman. The funeral service begins at 12. And then there's another giant. He didn't make it to so many years, but he's resting. But he has served the church as an elder, faithful for many years. The following week at 5 o'clock, we'll be having our service of songs for Elder Josiah before he goes off to Nigeria for his final rest. Let us all plan to be here. Amen. 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 Take your Bibles. And as we come to hear the Word of God, let us go to Romans chapter 13. Romans chapter 13, and I give you a minute to find it. And let us hear God speak to us. Time for the word. Taking from verse 11 in Romans chapter 13 to the end, the Bible says, and that knowing the time, knowing the time we're in, that it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we first believe. The night that we are going through is far spent. The day that we are waiting for is at hand. Let us therefore cast off our works of darkness, and let us all put on the armor of light. Amen. Let us walk honestly, as if we are walking in daytime, not in rioting or drunkenness, not in chamberings or wantonness, not in strife or envyings, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? Amen? And make no provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Amen. Verse 11. And knowing the time, that now it's high time to awake out of our sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we first believe. Amen. I want to speak for the next few moments on since we first believe. Let us pray. God in heaven, thank you for your church. Thank you for your blood. Thank you for your death. Thank you for the weekly assembly of worship on your Sabbath. Father, stand by your word now as you give me the privilege of speaking your word. In Jesus' name,
amen.
Amen. We are redeemed. We are children of the redemption. We are redeemed. I am redeemed. You are redeemed. And you should tell yourself every morning, I am redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Amen?
Amen.
You should. Because we are redeemed. The Bible says, if you are redeemed, then let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Are you hearing me? Redeemed through his infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Your testimony each day must be for the devil to hear and for the world to see, redeemed, and I'm so happy in Jesus. Can I get a testimony? No language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of his presence with me doth continually dwell. I think of my blessed Redeemer. I think of him all the day long. We are Christians. This is not a country club. This is a church. This is not Rotary Club. This is a fellowship of believers who are redeemed and journeying to the heavenly Canaan. We have one enemy and he's on the outside. Yeah, he's inside too, but he's not welcome. And we must let him not feel welcome. And when he is inside, we must give him hard work to do. We must not do his work for him. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. I know I shall see one day in his beauty the king in whose law I delight, who lovingly guarded, do you know the song? My footsteps, and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed. I know there's a crown that is waiting. Do you know that? In yonder bright mansion for me. And soon, with his spirit made perfect, at home with the Lord I shall be. You better be able to say it with certainty. Because Christ will soon be here. Psalm 107 said, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Is that you? And gather out of the lands from the east, from the west, from the north, from the south. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. We wandered in the desert in desolate places. We are wandering. We found no city in this world to dwell in. We are hungry and thirsty, and our souls fainted. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And then we cried out to the Lord in trouble, and he delivered us out of our distresses and led us forth by the right way, that we may go to his eternal city, a dwelling place. Am I talking to someone? Amen. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. And verse 8 of Psalm 107 says, oh, that men and women would give thanks to the Lord for his goodness. We are Seventh-day Adventists, aren't we? To outsiders and to ourselves, we are people of the Advent. We wake up every day because we believe that Jesus Christ is coming. Do you still believe it? We believe that he is coming soon. We are prisoners of hope. We believe we should never be surprised when the eastern sky cracks, when probation closes, when the world is plunged into darkness and cruelty. and the Spirit of God is withdrawn from the earth, and the devil take over men, especially men in high places, and you begin to see things that you never imagined, you should not be surprised. Because we are Seventh-day Adventists, prisoners of hope, and what we preach every day and what we study and the prophecies we are in, we must expect it to be fulfilled. It's going to be fulfilled. And so like Job, in Job chapter 19, verse 20, 25 through 27, we must be able to say every day, I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that the end, he will stand on this earth. And though after my skin has been destroyed, and my flesh, in my flesh still, I will see God. I myself, verse 27, Job says, will see him with my own eyes and not another. How my heart yearns within me. I want us all to get to that place. Get to that place where we go back to where we first believe. When you first met Christ, when they baptize you for the first time, when you feel that electric move through your system, when your heart was pulsating with love for God and His church, when you couldn't wait for the Sabbath, and you couldn't wait to pray and study the Word of God. We need to get back to that place. Amen. Where the promise of Jesus in John chapter 14, 1 to 3, keep echoing in my heart, where Christ said to His troubled disciples, let not your hearts be troubled. Do I get an amen here? If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are, if it were not true, I would have. I go and prepare a place. And if I go and prepare a place, I will come again. I need to believe that you believe it. Because I believe it. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13 through 17. The apostle says, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, like Dr. Ibanzo and Elder Josiah, lest you sorrow as others who do not have any hope. For if we believe that Jesus died, do you believe that?
Yes.
And rose again, then even so we must believe that God will bring those who are sleeping in Jesus. For this we say by the word of the Lord, that we are alive, if we are alive, and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means go before those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's our future. That's our destiny. Now, the Bible says, you know, no weapons formed against you shall prosper.
Amen.
But it means that the weapons are going to form. And they are going to be used on you. I don't know how. Some of us will lose jobs. Others will lose home. Some will lose health care. Some will lose their health. I don't know when the Spirit of God is withdrawn from the earth, how the devil is going to unleash his wickedness on the children of God. But I know he will. The thing is that God said the weapons will not prosper. And so we have to have faith. 2 Corinthians 15, 51 through 57, the Bible says, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we all shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal will put on immortality. Then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, O death, where is thy sting? And O grave, where is thy victory? Can you say amen? I remember a couple of years ago when I thought I was bright and liked to argue and debate. I've grown past a lot of things. Esoteric theology and trying to prove ego and competing. I'm past that. But a couple of years ago, I remember I approached a church in Sav Church in Westmoreland, Jamaica. I was heading to my bay, but it was Sabbath, so I paused to worship, and they were studying the Sabbath school, and I was arguing about the second coming of Christ, and if it's a certain thing, and I was pulling science, and I was arguing with a number of other guys, because we thought we knew something. And we made the case in Sabbath school that how do you know that God will come? Can you prove it to us? We thought we were bright. And an elderly woman got up. An elderly woman, obviously, from how she looked, it doesn't look like she went to college or anything. But she said, she looked at me and she said, son, the God I serve has never failed in any of his promises. Point me to one promise where God has failed. So if God has never failed in any of his promises, why do you think he's going to fail in his promise to come? And I took my seat and shut my mouth. Because I didn't have an answer to that. Jesus is coming. He has promised to come. The king is coming. The marriage supper of the Lamb will be held. The bridegroom will come for his bride. The new heaven and the new earth is going to be established. The Lord himself soon will descend from heaven with a shout. Those of us who are faithful will look up soon, for our redemption draweth nigh. This mortal, if we are faithful, will put on immortality soon. And beloved, those of us who are sons of God, it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Can you say amen? The second coming of Christ has driven me as a Seventh-day Adventist teenager. I was a teenager when I first heard about the coming of Christ. When I first saw it in a quarterly study on Revelation, and I gave my life to Jesus, it has driven the belief in the second coming of Jesus Christ has been the center that has driven my life from when I was a teen until today. Since I first believed, I've been calling men and women to Jesus Christ. And I was trying to calculate this week how many persons God has used through my efforts to lead people to Jesus, and I came up with 4,567. It all began since my conversion. And God has never placed me anywhere where I've regretted. He has never asked me to go anywhere that I've not gone. And he has called me since to serve in many places. Started out as an AY leader, then as a junior deacon, then as a junior elder. Then went on to seminary and became a pastor and a junior evangelist, serving in Jamaica. And then later on, he called me to Lake Region Conference to serve as pastor. And then back to Northern Caribbean University, where I serve as university pastor and professor. Then to Atlanta. And then he asked me to serve here at Houston International Seventh-day Adventist Church. Amen. Since 2018. God has called me to serve into Texas Conference. And I remember in 2018 when I was heading here, my mother said, "Who do you know in Texas?" I said, "No one." She said, "Why are you going?" I said, "Well, God called me." Amen. New state, new city, new conference, new colleagues, two new presidents since, three new secretaries since, new church at that time, new cultures that I've never been exposed to, new friends, new challenges, new opportunities, new reasons to pray, and new ways to grow, and the blessings kept on coming. Sandy. Amen. And Ashley. Amen. And Dylan. Amen. Thank you, Houston International. Amen. I am so happy right now, I don't know what to do with myself. Amen. Nothing can disturb my peace. Amen. Thank you, Houston International. Amen. And then COVID came. And ministry in our church changed. Everything moved online. Prayer lines. In our heyday, we had at least 10 prayer lines with at least 10 persons on each prayer line, making it 100 persons. And we remained connected through COVID. Then I asked Sister Green to create a social group so we could talk, because for over a year, we could not meet here. We went online. So we have the social WhatsApp group. And we are still using it. Amen. The men's group went online. Then we went to parking lot ministry. Do you remember? Yes. And now we have a long playlist on YouTube. Yes. And Houston International Church is everywhere. Amen. Ministry expanded as persons got motivated in over 30 active ministries. Amen. In this church. You heard it earlier with Elder Bookie. It's a busy church. Sometimes it's tiring. Amen. To hear it. And we expanded to our youth church. And our youth ministry. Amen. And our children's church. Amen. And as we move on, you know, sometimes somebody says, "Why do you work so hard at the church? Why are you doing it?" And I said, "I don't do it for people. I do it for God." Amen. It's not enough, the renovation ministry. People are pouring into Houston, one of the largest cities in the United States of America. From all over the world, they need, when they pass on the highway, to see something attractive. So we clean up the parking lot, and we clean up the church. Fresh carpet, sign on the outside, huh? So people could come on in. Change out the audio visual. Well, you have TV now, big TV. I was telling asking Elder Cliff earlier, they're not big enough. And he said, "Pastor, that's the biggest we can get." Chill. Chill. Renovated inside and outside. The kitchen, we had curb appeal. Trucks start parking on the outside, and we made a complaint. So if you see all them signs scattered all over there, that is up. Don't tell them that we did it. Because we didn't want to attract the wrong element. And every year since 2018, God has sent us souls to be baptized. Amen. We have never completed a year in this church without people giving their life to Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? When COVID came, we thought we'd go down financially, but talk to the treasurer. Every year since COVID, we have gone up and up and up in our finances. Every week, we have visitors coming through those doors seeking a place to connect and to give their lives to Jesus Christ. And since coming to Texas, God has blessed me with some amazing friends. I'm looking at you. And I'm tempted to call names. And Cindy said, if you open your mouth and start calling names, you're going to get in trouble. You're going to miss somebody. And they're going to crucify you. Gentlemen, if you want to be happy, listen to the wife. Happy wife, happy life. I know us, we tend to be stubborn, but listen to the wife there on your side. You prosper, they know that. You suffer, or they abandon you. Listen to the wife. But I'm looking at some beautiful people in this church. Who I love. I didn't hear, and I don't want to hear. And as I thought about the many wonderful persons in Houston International Church, there's a song that came to me, said that if he keeps on blessing and blessing, and if he keeps on pouring it on, do you know it? If his love just keeps getting richer and he keeps on giving a song, if my cup get fuller and fuller, if my prayers keep going through, if God keep on blessing and blessing, then, oh Lord, I don't know what to do. Since I gave my heart to Jesus, since I claim him as my king, then the glooms and fears were lifted, and my old heart just started to sing. The songs just keep getting better, and it thrills my heart through and through. If it keeps on getting better and better, oh Lord, I don't know what I'm going to do. You don't know it? My goodness. If he keeps on... Oh, I can't sing. Since I gave my heart to Jesus, since I claim him as my king, then my burdens and fears were lifted. My whole heart just started to sing. Then the song just keep getting better, and it thrilled my heart through and through. If it keeps on getting better and better, oh Lord, I don't know what I'm gonna do. Amen. 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 2 Timothy was read beautifully this morning. And I want to read it again before I take my seat. 2 Timothy chapter 4. I was going to read it from verse 6. Let me read. The Bible says, the apostle writes, and I'm borrowing his words, "For I'm now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I've fought a good fight. I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give to me at that day. And not to me only, but to all them also, that love is appearing. Do thy diligence to come shortly to me, for Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world, and is departed unto Thessalonica." Verse 11, only Luke is with me. "Take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. And Tychicus have I sent to Ephesus. The cloak that I left at Troas with Carpus, when you come, bring it with you, and the books, especially parchments. Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works. Of whom be ye aware also, for he is greatly withstood our words. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsake me. I pray, God, that it may not be laid to their charge. Amen. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me that by the preaching might be fully known, that all Gentiles might hear, and I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. Amen. The Lord shall deliver me from every evil work and will preserve me in his heavenly kingdom. To whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Salute Prisca and Aquila and the household of Onesimus. Erasmus abode at Corinth, but Trophimus have I left at Miletus sick. Do thy diligence to come before winter. Eusebius greet thee, and Prudence, and Linus, and Claudia, and all the brethren. The Lord Jesus Christ be with thy spirit, and grace be unto you.
Amen.
Can you say amen?
Amen?
This was Paul's testimony at the end of his service. We only know the part that he says, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but to all them that love his appearance. And we know verse 6, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. We have served Houston International since 2018. And the time of our service is at an end. We are now called to serve in another section of God's vineyard, a mission opportunity where there is something more to do. And we have accepted. The time of our service is at an end. And we're asking that you be pray for us that we'll be faithful. And we are praying that you will be faithful as well. And I want to end with Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. Where the Bible says, this will be my last counsel. Unto the angel of the church at Ephesus write, these things said he that hold the seven stars in his right hand, and he who walk in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know your works. I know your labor, and I know your patience, how you cannot bear them that are evil. And you have tried them that say that they are apostles and have found them to be liars. You have borne and have patience for my name's sake. You have labored and you have not fainted. But Christ said to Ephesus, nevertheless, I have something against you, because you have left your first love. Remember, therefore, this is my counsel, Jesus said, to the church at Ephesus. It's a counsel we want to borrow today for myself and for all of us. Remember, therefore, from whence you have fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly, and I will remove your candlestick out of its place, except you repent. Amen. This is not our last Sabbath, but our last Sabbath will be on the 9th. So we have 3 more Sabbaths with you. So we can love each other, we can fellowship, we can say goodbye. But I do not regret my time here. God sent me here. And he told me how long I would have been here. And I stayed over one extra year from what he told me. And then he said, it's time. As we continue to labor for him, working together. But I've met some great people here. We are Seventh-day Adventists. Jesus Christ is coming soon. Amen. Let us pray with one another, pray for one another, and push each other into the kingdom.
Amen.
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 There won't be any gated community in heaven. We are exclusively just some of us going to be in it. Heaven is going to be an open place where all of us are welcome. And I'm hoping to see every single one of you there.
Amen.
Soon.
Amen.
Promise me.
Amen. What a powerful message. I ask us all to rise now for our closing hymn. Hymn 430. Joy by and by.
Joy when the reapers gather home.
can be emotional at times, you know. Benediction.
Yes.
We lift up our eyes unto the hills, from whence comes our help. Our help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and the earth.
Amen.
And I pray, He will not allow your foot to be moved.
Yes.
He who keeps you shall not slumber.
Amen.
Behold, He who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep.
Amen.
The Lord is your keeper.
Yes, yes.
The Lord is your light at your right hand.
Amen.
The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night.
Yes.
The Lord shall preserve you from all evil.
Yes.
He shall preserve your soul.
Yes, he does.
The Lord shall preserve you from your going out and your coming in.
Amen.
From this time forth,
yes,
and forevermore.
Amen.
Be seated. The deacons will dismiss in rows.